KCAL 9 News at 8.
All right, we've heard all the evidence in the trial of Michael Jackson's doctor. Tomorrow, the all-important closing arguments before the jury gets this case. The prosecution will argue that Dr. Murray's reckless inattention to a sedated Jackson led to his death. The defense will argue that the singer administered the lethal dose of propofol himself, and Dr. Conrad Murray could do nothing to save him.
And tonight, as we do every night at 8:30, we have in-depth coverage and analysis of the Jackson case for you.
22 days of trial, 49 witnesses, and now it all comes down to closing arguments.
That's right, but one person may already be looking ahead to the period after the trial. Reports say Dr. Conrad Murray is already shopping his story. KCAL9's Randy Page has details.
If you're wondering what was going through Dr. Conrad Murray's mind while he watched former patients take the stand and speak of his humility and compassion.
Do you think Dr. Murray's greedy?
Do I think?
Yes, ma'am.
No.
Or his thoughts when bodyguard Alberto Alvarez broke down while describing the moment Michael Jackson's children came into the bedroom.
Paris screamed out, "Daddy." Dr. Conrad Murray said, "Don't let them see their dad like this."
You may soon find out. The New York Post today is reporting Conrad Murray has been participating in daily on-camera interviews throughout the trial, and that he signed over the rights to the video diary, which would include a sit-down interview with Murray, as a package deal the production company hopes to sell to a TV network for $1 million, according to unnamed sources at the Post. We have confirmed CNN was approached, but has chosen to decline on the footage. Other Post sources say NBC is close to completing the deal, possibly for the Today Show. So would these interviews violate Judge Michael Pastor's gag order?
Technically he is, because he may be speaking with someone, filming whatever documentary he's putting together. But broadly speaking, no, because it's not being disseminated to the media.
Another legal question. If Conrad Murray is convicted of involuntary manslaughter, would he be allowed to financially benefit from his crime?
Short answer is yes.
McBride says the California law that prohibits convicted felons from profiting from their crimes does not extend to involuntary manslaughter.
Inside the criminal courts building, I'm Randy Page, KCAL 9 News.
KCAL 9 legal analyst Steve Meister joins us now. He's a veteran defense attorney and former prosecutor.
All right, Steve, we're going to make you put on your prosecutor's tie, and it's time for your closing arguments.
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
Sure.
All right.
I would get up in front of that jury, and I would say that Michael Jackson is dead because he made the fatal mistake of trusting a doctor who shouldn't have been allowed within a mile of any patient who wanted to live through the night. This was rinky-dink, ticky-tack, Alice in Wonderland, meatball, Mad Hatter medicine, if you can call it that. And that's why Michael Jackson died, because he was in the care of someone who wasn't responsible enough, wasn't competent enough, wasn't experienced enough, and wasn't strong enough to resist the overtures of a patient and perhaps of others in the patient's life who wanted the patient to succeed financially. And this drug, propofol, which shouldn't have been anywhere near a house, was practically covering the walls in this Beverly Hills mansion.
And there was money involved, we should point out. He was making a hefty sum.
A lot of money. And I would remind the jury that Conrad Murray seemed to be able to enjoy and keep most of it for himself. For after all, he didn't spend any of it hiring a nurse or an anesthesiologist or a backup doctor or reading up on administration of propofol or anesthesiology. I didn't see any expensive phone bills that he had by calling people like Stephen Schaefer and Paul White, world-renowned experts on propofol who he probably didn't even know before this trial. And I would show that this was motivated by greed and then perhaps a desire to make up for those years when he was struggling in Houston with that clinic he started.
All right, so let's say if he's convicted, why does he get to keep that kind of money?
What do you mean?
If he's convicted, is he allowed to keep that money, that the $1 million that he was paid?
He could be, apparently, because as we were seeing, involuntary manslaughter is not on the list of crimes from which you can't benefit financially.
Oh, okay.
What's the key piece of testimony as far as you're concerned?
The key piece of testimony to me is from nurse practitioner Sherilyn Lee, and we have her bite. That I think we'll toss to.
Yes.
I'm telling you, the only thing that's going to help me to sleep right away is the Depravan. and can you find someone to help me to sleep?
And he responded again, I will be okay. I only need someone to monitor me with the equipment while I sleep.
Yes, that's exactly what he said.
Why is this testimony so important?
It's golden. Because if I were the prosecutor, I would hammer home that Michael Jackson and Conrad Murray may have agreed about a lot of things. For example, that it was okay to give propofol to someone in his living room instead of a hospital, which it wasn't. It was insane to do that. But the one thing they disagreed about was whether or not he should be monitored. Even Michael Jackson knew he should be monitored under propofol, and he trusted his doctor to take care of him, and the doctor didn't monitor him. And because of this, he's dead.
All right, so how do you compel the jury to go with involuntary manslaughter? Negligence, I'm just guessing here. Negligence seems pretty strong that they're gonna figure out that there was some negligence involved. But what about involuntary manslaughter?
Because you take a look at all of the surrounding circumstances and the fact that at UCLA, I would argue he lied to UCLA docs by omitting mention of propofol. And I would remind them of a line from the movie MASH, mm-hmm. where someone busts in on the commanding officer's tent and says, this isn't a hospital, it's an insane asylum, and it's your fault. And I would remind them that this wasn't even medicine. This wasn't even an incredible simulation of medicine. This was money-driven quackery that got an innocent man killed.
All right, okay. We're going to make you switch sides now. Yeah. Now you're where you're most comfortable these days as a defense attorney. Let's hear your closing arguments to the jury.
Oh, goodness, look at the time. I must be going. You know what I would tell them? I would tell them, this isn't a case about shared responsibility. There's only one man to blame mm-hmm. that someone died here. There's only one man on whose shoulders rests the responsibility for leaving two children fatherless and a family grieving and fans worldwide mourning the loss of a... He was more than a once-in-a-generation talent. He was a once-in-a-century talent. There's only one man to blame for this. And that man is Michael Jackson. And that's how I would open, mm-hmm. by pounding home the fact that Michael Jackson was a drug addict, right. according to the evidence, that he desperately sought this drug that doctors would testify he shouldn't have been administering. And he found a doctor who was caring enough mm-hmm. and compassionate enough and manipulable enough mm-hmm. to accommodate his needs.
Well, let's talk about the star witness for the defense was Dr. White, right?
Dr. Paul White. Mm-hmm. He was a good witness. I would compare Dr. White with Dr. Schaefer and say, of the two of these people, Dr. White was calm. He was confident without being cocky. He was deliberate. You didn't see any of these wild, theatric gesticulations from my witness folks because my witness didn't need to do that. And while he said it may have been unconventional, this was the guy who was the father of propofol, and he said it wasn't deadly.
And there he is.
Let's listen to what he has to say.
Yeah, let's listen to the testimony.
Thank you. Fusion setup. So you think it was a self-injection of propofol near the hour of between 11:30 and 12 o'clock that they did it?
In my opinion, yes.
Okay. This was accidental suicide. If there is such a thing. This was an accidental death, but it wasn't caused by Dr. Murray. It was caused by Michael Jackson, and the scientific evidence supported it. You don't have to buy into Schaefer's wild, again, theatric displays. You can simply listen to Paul White's sound, scientific, and ultimately undisputed theory that this was what could have happened.
Steve, we appreciate that. You know, you have a little bit of a split personality.
So I've been told.
Prosecution and defense. Made both of your cases very well.
It's a dark place to live.
It is.
Well, thank you so much. We're not finished with you, by the way, because Steve's going to continue to be here until this trial is over with his analysis of the Conrad Murray trial.
Right. And to learn more about Steve and his work, just go to our website, his website. Why don't we go to his website, meisterlawoffices.com. All right, coming up in court tomorrow, the closing arguments, in-depth coverage right here on KCAL all day long and streaming on our website, CBSLA.com.